Hello and welcome to the new Yankee Workshop, Season 3, Episode 5, The Shaker Wall Clock. Norm visits the Hancock Shaker Village in Massachusetts to see one of the surviving wall clocks built by Shaker craftsman Isaac Young. Norm's version of the clock improves on the best one with the use of a quartz timepiece that costs only $5. Made from handsome walnut, it is a small, elegant piece that fits into any decor. Enjoy!
Here in the Shaker community, the brothers and sisters didn't own pocket watches. They didn't need them. They told time by the ringing of the bell. It would wake them in the morning, call them to meals or to worship, and even warn them in case of emergency. What clocks they had were very special and reserved for special places. Let me show you. All the clocks that are in this building were built by the same Shaker, Isaac Young's. This room was set up for the sisters to do things like knitting, sewing, or darning of things like socks. Now over here above this sewing chest is one of his clocks, built over 150 years ago. The materials used are fairly thin. It's not 3/4 inch thick material, it's thinner. Now there was probably a pendulum here because you can see the material has been scalloped out so that it would swing freely. Look at these windows on the sides. It allows you to see the clockworks. The gears are made out of wood, only the shafts appear to be metal. You know, but the thing I really like about this clock are the proportions. I'd also like to take a moment to talk about shop safety. Be sure to read, understand, and follow all the safety rules that come with your power tools. Knowing how to use your power tools properly will greatly reduce the risk of personal injury. But remember this. There is no more important safety rule than to wear these safety glasses. Now I'll show you how I built today's project. I think what I'm going to do is set this back here on the bench to give us some inspiration as I show you how we built the project. Now over here is some walnut, which is what the clock is made of. Picked it up at my local hardwood store, and you can see it has a lot of character, and once in a while, a little defect like a knot. But with a piece like this clock, we can cut all those imperfections out. Now, I was only able to get 3/4 inch thick stock. And since I want to stick to the original and use 9/16 thickness, 1/2 inch thickness, I need to thin it down. Now I could run it through my table saw and rip it, but I'm going to end up with a pretty rough surface, and you just can't sand something like that to the point of where it's workable. So I'm going to use my thickness planer. Okay, now I'll raise it up another 30 seconds. And I want to make sure now that I flip the board over so I plane a side that hasn't been done yet. And I'll continually flip it as I go through the process because I want to end up with a board with uniform moisture content. That way I won't have cupping later on. Okay, that's for the back, this is for the doors. Okay, that should be enough. The next thing I want to do is make the sides of the clock case, and I can get both pieces out of this one board. But before I rip them, I want to make sure that I've got a perfectly square edge and that it's smooth. So I'll use my joiner. Now the idea here is that you hold the board firmly down on the bed and against the fence, which is set at 90 degrees. And I'll take a 30 second off each edge. Well, now I can use those jointed edges against my rip fence. Now, the final width of my piece is 3 1/8, but I'm going to set it about a 30 second wider, because even though I'll get a nice smooth cut with this blade, a final pass through the joiner will make it perfect. Well, Well, next I'll cut the sides to the correct length. First thing I want to do is just set it in my miter box and square up one end. Now I'll slide it down up against my stop, which has been set at exactly 30 3/8 inches, and make the second cut. Okay, now let's go take another look at the prototype. The back of the clock case fits into some rabbets that have been cut in the sides, and that's so I won't see them through the edges. And also, there's another rabbet cut in each side piece at the top and bottom. Let me wet that a little bit so you can see it better. There's a rabbet joint that connects these cross pieces. I'll make those rabbets over here on the table saw. You know, the thing that I really like about this stacked dado setup is that it gives me a nice flat cut. Now, without changing any of the setup, but adding my miter gauge, I can now make the rabbets at the top and bottom of each side piece. Now there's one more milling step that I have to do to the side pieces. This half inch division rail needs a little dado that it can sit in so it'll be firmly set in place. And I'll do that here at the workbench. I've clamped the side firmly in place. I'm using this straight edge clamp to guide my router so that I can remove some material right in this layout area here. Now the router is set up with a half inch straight cutting bit, and I'll just guide it against the edge. Now I'll just use a nice sharp chisel to square up the back corners. Well, now it's time for a little assembly. I'm going to put some glue on those dados that are at the top and bottom of the sides. Spread it out with a brush, and we can put the cross pieces in. Now I want to make sure I hold the cross piece flush on the front side. Get that nice and even. And just use my brad nailer with some 3/4 inch brads to fasten it. Now the center rail, which fits in the little dados that I've made, also needs to come out and hang over the side just a little bit. So I need to make a notch on each end. Now the center divider rail is lightly eased or rounded over. And to do that, I'm going to use my router. And I've set it up with a 1/4 inch rounding over bit. But I've only revealed a little bit of it because I don't want that full 1/4 round. Well, a little bit of glue in those dados. I'll slip the piece in and attach it with a couple brads. The next piece to work on is the back of the clock case. And the only tricky part is this little half round portion up at the top where the clock will actually hang from the wall. Now I've taken my blank and laid out the cut, and I'm going to use my handheld jigsaw to make both the straight and the curved cuts. Takes care of smoothing out the cut. Now we'll put a hole right in the center. Now that's a 1/2 inch hole to hang the clock from. Now we can install the back on the case. Now the back gets installed with nails only. Don't use any glue because this board is more than likely to shrink a little bit. I'm going to start out by putting a nail right in the center of the bottom. One up here at the center of the top. Now, you might expect that I would nail the rest of the back right along the edge of this rabbet. If I do that and the board shrinks, it'll probably split right up the middle. So what I'm going to do is tip it up on the side and nail through the sides, and that way the board won't split. There are two more pieces on the clock case, one at the bottom and one at the top. They're identical in overall size, and they hang out over the sides of the cabinet about 5/8 of an inch and also out in front of the door. It's been shaped, not really a quarter round, more of a flare. Now to make that flare, I'm going to use my router table, which I've set up with a 3/4 inch radius bit, and I'll pass the blanks through, ends first, then the front edge. Now the top piece has to have a notch in it, right along the middle portion, to fit around this hanger part of the back. Okay, let's check the fit. That's pretty good. Now I think I'll just put a little bit of glue along the top, nothing fancy, and I'll secure it in place with a few brads. Now we're ready to start working on the doors. The top door has a glass panel in it, and the bottom door has a wooden panel in it. Both of these elements sit in rabbeted stiles and rails, and then are held in place with a tiny quarter-round molding. Here I've got my router table set up to make those rabbets, and I've installed a 3/8 inch rabbeting bit. And I've done some adjustments until I've got it just right, and run a sample of scrap stock through. As you can see, the rabbet is going to be 3/8 of an inch by 3/16 of an inch. The stiles and rails of the door are joined by a mortise and tenon joint. There'll be a mortise in the stiles and tenons on the ends of the rails. I'm going to do the mortises first, over here at the drill press. I've set up this mortising attachment, which includes a square chisel through which slides a drill bit. The drill bit removes most of the material, and the chisel squares it up as we plunge down into the work. Well, I've already made the tenons on the rails for the top door. I'm going to use those as an example to show you how the whole system fits together. Here's the tenon all milled properly, and it simply slides into the mortise of the stile. Now notice that there's a couple different shoulder cuts. One of the shoulder cuts is on the face side right here, and that'll butt into the stile at this location. There's another shoulder cut on the back side of the rail, which butts into this area of the stile. Now all these cuts will be made on the table saw. To make the shoulder cut on the back side of each rail, I simply have to move my rip fence over exactly 3/16 of an inch. Take note that the mortises are held back from the ends of the stiles. And because of that, I'm going to have to make a haunched tenon. And that material is best removed using the table saw, just nibbling it away. Well, there's one more milling operation on the tenons, and that's to make the cheek cuts. The back cut is a little bit thicker than the front cut. Well, now I've got to make a slight adjustment to my tenoning jig to remove a little bit more material for the other cheek cut. Well, now, the only thing that's going to hold these mortise and tenon joints together is a little bit of yellow carpenter's glue. Now, the Shakers would have used pegs because they didn't have the advantage of the modern adhesives that we use. Now I'm ready to start making the mortises for my hinges. Now, there are 4 hinges, which means they're going to be 8 mortises. So I decided to make a jig to do all the cuts. The jig has a little notch in it here, which is 1/16 of an inch bigger than the size of the hinge or the mortise. And that's to compensate for this collar that I've installed on my router, which surrounds the 1/2 inch bit. And the idea is that the collar will follow the notch and cut the mortise. That sure makes quick work of it. Now I'll do that to both doors and the case. Okay, I think I will square up these mortises before I move on to the case. And to do that, I'll just use a chisel, just mostly hand pressure, just pushing down, removing the little corner. So there'll be no surprises later, I'm going to mark the mortises on the case using the mortises I've already cut in the doors as a guide. Well, the brass screws for these hinges are really nice, but they're soft, so I'm taking the precaution of pre-drilling the holes. I need a wood panel for my lower door, but I only have room for a piece that's about 1/8 of an inch thick, and that's kind of flimsy. So I'm going to use an old-timer's trick, which is to take a thick piece of wood and bevel the edges, sort of like a raised panel to give me that extra strength. I've made a jig for my table saw. It's a few pieces of plywood screwed together that slide along the rip fence. The large panel is for the blank to sit in, and this is a stop to hold it in place. With the panel clamped in place and the blade tilted to a 15-degree angle, I'm ready to make the cuts. It works great. Now, to hold the glass and wooden panels into these rabbets, I need a little molding. And it's 1/4 inch quarter round. It's rounded over and square on the back. Obviously, you can't mill a piece of stock this small. So I've set up my router table with 1/4 inch rounding over bit and a couple feather boards to hold the stock in place. And I'm going to take a piece that's about 3/4 of an inch square and round off 2 corners. Now, with those 2 cuts made and a slight adjustment to the rip fence, the next pass through the table saw will give me the moldings I need. Well, I suppose I could miter all these moldings with my utility knife, but the wood trimmer does a great job. Okay, what I'm going to do is spend a little bit of time dry fitting all the moldings around both doors. Well, I think the best way to put these moldings in place is with the hot glue gun. A couple dabs of glue, just squeeze it in place. Now these three little cleats will hold a piece of plywood, which in turn holds the clock works and the clock face. But I don't want to install those now, I want to put the finish on first. Now for a finish on my piece, I've chosen a Danish oil. And to make it a little richer and darker, I've added a little bit of Danish walnut stain. I'm going to put it on with a brush, let it sit for a while, and wipe it down with a rag. 5 or 6 coats later, it should look just about right. Now my knobs for the clock are actually made out of maple. I couldn't get walnut ones. And stain won't penetrate deeply enough just rubbing it on. So what I'm going to do is place them in a bucket of stain, or actually a cup of stain, and let them sit for a few hours, and that should do the job. Okay, now with the oil all nice and dry, I can finish installing the works. The quartz movement just fits through this piece of 3/8-inch plywood, and it sits on my cleats. And I'll just tack that in place with some brads. Okay, now I'm ready to install the clock face. I'm going to take this nut off, put a dab of glue in each corner to keep it from curling up. Now the hands, the hour hand first. Hand and a little nut that holds it down. Okay, now if I need to change the battery on this clock in a year or so, I can reach up from the lower compartment and put a new one in. The last thing is this little piece of trim that just goes down the bottom to fill that gap, and I'll just tack that in place with a brad. And I'd say that that just about finishes it up. I think it looks pretty good. Well, there it is. Our clock is all nicely oiled and polished. You know, I have a hunch that this is a piece that's going to get handed down for quite a few generations in my family.
Thank you for watching. For more, please like and subscribe.